Well, anyway, how many of you know League of Legends? Okay, so at least you know it. Well then, if you've ever wanted to have a weapon like that, a weapon like this, built in real life, then you've certainly come to the right tent today. Combustor over here has embarked on a journey to craft a weapon like this, and he's going to share his experiences with us. So please all welcome Combustor.
There's a few things I want to go through today. I set this up like a small talk about how you can use fabricate crystals, you can apply them, you can make things with them, and it's like a sort of instructional course on how to do those things. You can make small things, you can make big things. So what's the plan? We have a small introduction of how crystallization works, how to do that, and how to make good use of it. And when we've done with the whole technique part, I'll go through the entire building part of the hammer over here. After that, there's time for questions, and because it's quite difficult to see all the details from the room, so afterwards you can come over here and see all the things up close, and we can talk about it. Crystallization. It's an interesting part of chemistry. You don't usually see that in regular textbooks. Basically, what happens is that you have one thing that's only partially soluble. So you have water, usually, and you have something else that only dissolves for a bit in water until it thinks like, man, there's not enough space for me, so I go back out of the water. That's the way how crystals grow in real life. It's also how stalactites and stalagmites grow in caves. You have limestone being dissolved in water, then it drops down, and water evaporates for a bit, and the remaining limestone things have to go somewhere. And then you get these drops and pillars. The thing about crystals is that some material likes to be will tend to fit. Molecules have shapes basically, and what they do is they tend to find a nice way to be lying next to each other. And the consequence of that is that if you have one sort of molecule, it will generate one shape that's specific to that molecule, but some other molecule will make a different shape. So if we want to make crystals, then we have to find some solution, put things in there, and then try to get it back out of the solution. The way we do that is we have there is a certain amount of solid available. But we can change the ratios to which that solid can be in the fluid. The thing about that is the moment you increase the temperature, for instance, of water, then you can dissolve more things in that. Like if you have sugar, then it won't dissolve in cold water, but it will dissolve in hot water. So if we increase the temperature, we increase the amount of room for sugar or anything else that can be in the water. And if we later go cool it down, the result is that there is not enough space left, and then it will become solid again. And usually it will form crystals at the same time. This is also the way they usually make the real big fake gemstones like rubies and sapphires, as they use in lasers. That needs to be really hot, and then they dip one cold element into the center of a big hot pan, And at that point, the temperature is too low for all the stuff to remain in there, so it will form a crystal at the top of that pike, and then they just pull it out, and you get one long rod of ruby. Lowering the temperature won't only work so far. If you make something like that and you let it cool off, and at the end it will be cooled and it won't do anything anymore. So if you have something based on water, you want to do that for a while longer. So if you put that somewhere in sunlight or something, the water will start evaporating, but not things that have a way higher boiling point or melting point. So sugar does not. What happens? The water evaporates, and then the amount of water becomes too low for the sugar, and the process continues. If you use that method, basically, the process is a lot it takes a lot more time. But if you give it more time, it gives the elements in the water more time to find their preferred position. So if you want large crystals, you have to wait a long time. If you want a lot of small crystals, you just bump up the temperature and cool it really quickly, and then you get much smaller things. So how do you do that in your kitchen? Everyone can get sugar. Everyone can get water, and probably everyone has a stove. The ratio for sugar to water is normally 3-1. So you find yourself a cup of water, you put it in, and then you add 3 cups of sugar to it. And then you boil the whole stuff. And at some point, every bit of sugar in there will be dissolved. That is your basic solution. Then at that point, you can take it off the furnace and put it somewhere, and then you will grow crystals on your pan. It's probably not the best thing you want. So you can do you put other things in there. If you want to clean your pan afterwards, it's easy. You just put hot water from the tap back in, and you keep stirring it. And at some point, it will just dissolve and go down the sink. So that's pretty easy to clean up afterwards. So no dangerous substances involved. One other thing, though, is that if you have that much sugar in water, the boiling point of water will also go up above 100 degrees. So, and the result is quite sticky. So if you do pour it on yourself, you are in quite a bit of trouble. So be careful with that. Yeah, like I said, if you just make the solution in a pan, you let it cool down, the crystals will grow on the pan. So then the next thing is you have to put something else in that you want to grow your crystals on. You can use regular sticks, then you make sugar crystals on a stick, the tongue kind that you see. They sell those things for in your cup of tea. What people usually do is a piece of rope, that also works. But taking that to the next step is if you want to make gem-like objects, like we saw a bunch of rings in the first slide. You can make them just by printing a ring or fabricating it from something else and then just dipping the top end into the solution. And if you let it stay there for a while, then the crystals will also grow on here and on the cup and everywhere else, but you want them on here in the end. So if you dip it too deep, then it will stick to everything else that's in connection. So you have to be a bit careful about that. A few other things to take care of is, like, if you print something with a really smooth surface, you can just tick it off at any time again. That's probably not what you want. So if you want something that will stick to an object, you either have to bind it in some way, or you have to 3D print your object with a rough texture on top so that the sugar has more surface area to connect to. The thing is with dropping things upside down into a sugar solution is that your rough area might actually contain air and not water. So you have to make sure that the deepest point is actually connected to the outside world. Then it will automatically. What you can also do is actually use a bit of your molten sugar and first pour it on top so that you fill the holes and then quickly put it inside. And then the same thing will happen, basically. What I did with these ones, with these rings, I put them on a string from the top. But 3D printed plastic will basically just float on the material itself. So if you have something that is stable, you can just put it on top, leave it there, and you can go away, and you don't have to worry about shaking it any other time. And crystals will grow exactly where you plan to have them. Like I said, if you grow a lot of crystals, then they will stick to the pan. They will stick to whatever container you drop them in. They also will generate basically at the top of the solution. So if you leave it for too long, the top area, it starts to evaporate. There will be sugar to go away, and it will actually solidify the top. You can pull it out once in a while. It's actually good to poke a few holes in there so that actually more water can evaporate after that. Otherwise, it will get stuck in the process. But at the end, you're left with quite a bit of sugar in your container and very little sugar on your object. So what you can do is two things. You can basically take everything out and put it back in the pan as raw sugar. You have to be aware that if you do that, the sugar already contains some water, and that the ratio is no longer one cup of water to 3 cups of sugar. The normal way to find that out is just put some water in the pan and then keep adding the sugar until there will be a layer of grease on the bottom that's basically undissolved sugar. And then you know that you've reached your correct ratio. What you can also do is, if you have a lot of spare crystals, you can remove them from your container and you can store them for later. The thing is, if you grow something, it will grow in whatever way it feels like. You have pretty much little control over that. So if you have just some spare crystals laying around, then you can take, oh, this thing looks nice, let's just glue it somewhere else. And then you can have exactly the ring with quite more of the shape that you want. One thing to note is, well, if you get large chunks of solid sugar out of this, and if you try to dissolve that, you have to leave it cooking for quite a while. And one of the other problems of sugar is that at some point it will not dissolve, it will also start caramelizing, and at that point it's kind of wasted material. So to prevent that is you probably want to grind it down in some way, or dissolve only a little bit of it and then add fresh sugar at the end so that you don't have to wait all the time for it to actually dissolve. The other thing you can do is you can color your solution. There's a lot of things you can pour in. One of the things to be aware of is that they actually used crystallization in the past to purify materials. So if you have water and there's sugar in it and there's also some other things in it, the sugar will try to go away, but it will try also leave all the other things behind. So if you dye something, then in general, most of the dye will stay behind in the water and not contained within the sugar. So you might need to overdo that, and even though your water looks like the good color, it will be pretty pale when it comes out. Like everything on here is dyed in green, but it's almost white when you look at it from a distance. It's still noticeable, but that's one of the things you figure out at some point. Things you can do, you can get yourself some food dyes, you can find yourself some non-edible dyes. You can also you can use also make some of your own dye. If you cook particularly colorful vegetables, for instance, then you can eat for it, and then you can also keep the remains and store it for later, and then you have red dye, which is actually pretty strongly colored. What also works is that if you have your leftover solution, you have some crystals part of it, but you also have some liquid fraction left of it, and then you can basically reuse that and replenish it with existing materials. That means you also don't need to always need to have to regenerate your solution, even if even though it's dyed or not. You have leftover gems after each iteration. What often happens is that you get chunks like this, the bottom of a pot. And you can't do much with that, basically, often, but it will also grow on the sides where it doesn't go down to the bottom. Then you get get very large crystals, and they are pretty much separated. So if you get them out of the pot afterwards, you can then later use that to decorate specific things in specific locations. Basically like you would use a processed gem into a normal ring. Once you do that, you can glue that with normal means, or you can put braces around that like you do with real gems. One of the other things you can actually do is dip the crystal back in the solution, or dip the ring back in the crystal in the solution, and then stick them together. And then the bit of solution that's between them will eventually dry out and bind to pretty firmly together. One of the other things that happens is that crystals will grow on crystals, and they will grow out of the way. And what particularly happened in this case is that if you look at it, these parts are printed in quarters. I don't have a container large enough to put it entirely in, so I had to put it in one square at a time. What happens at the end is that the crystals will not only grow outwards, they'll also grow that way and that way, which means you can't connect the parts at the end. What you can do about that... what you can do about that is basically reverse the process. If you put it back in water, then the crystals will eventually dissolve, even though it's cold water. You have to be so if you want to trim an edge, you just find a place to lift it up to in a container with water. You fill it up to the level you want, and then you come back like one day later, and the edge is pretty much trimmed to what you want. You have to be careful with that. The sugar crystals like to take up a lot of water, and then they will fall apart afterwards. So if you drop it to exactly the same level, it will soak up the water to there and a whole bunch of crystals above it, and it will basically trim off more than what the water level actually says. So far for our production things, now I'm going to do some 3D things. The hammer over here is basically a copy of the hammer they used to have in League of Legends, especially the Terex hammer. This is my replica. And of course, there are quite a few things that have been done besides crystallization stuff. So if you want to make large props like this, there's a few other things that I want to go through. The whole thing is basically screwed together. There are certainly a lot of parts in the bottom end. Each of them is pretty small and has to fit on a 3D printer bed. I've screwed everything together in the end, or at least for the bottom part. I'll get to the top part later. You have to be. The thing is, screws are nice, but if you give them a bit of space, they will come loose, and you don't want your prop to fall apart like halfway into the event. Last time I came back home, I had four or five loose screws inside, but that's not a problem with the design. Every side of the hammer consists of two rings. Each ring is eight parts, and the two rings are connected by a fraction of that. So every hole in the top and the sides actually connects to a different part. So if you lose one screw there, then the connection still remains through all the other parts. That does leave for quite a bit of screws to assemble in pretty confined area. And one of the things I did for that in the end was I made an entire, basically a very small M3 wrench that was the same size of the part itself, so that you can actually turn it in the area that it was given, instead of having those large things that do not really work in that space. Basically, what I wanted is that you couldn't see any mounting material at the outside. So everything is screwed from the inside, but at some point you have to close the area. What I did is the inner ring has a pair of dovetails. Those can carry a lot of weight and tension. And they basically connect the closing part to the body. Inside this thing is what you can't see. There's basically a broomstick, and that goes through both ends, and then it's screwed through these holes with a pair of big screws. And outside there's another ring where you can place a cover on top. That works like this. There's a hole with nooks, and if you put it in, you can twist it. And if you make that tight enough, then it also won't fall off again. If you have a lot of them, then at some point a few will strain. Okay, so there's these cover the till end and all the way up to here. And what happens at the end is that to prevent them from screwing back, there's another screw at the end over here, so that this one is fixed. There's a screw at the bottom that's fixed, and these two prevent all the intermediate parts from rotating and unscrewing themselves. I templated these things so I can change the inner diameter, the outer diameter, and make sure they fit exactly the broomstick that's holding them. The problem is that at the end you have a pair of joints that you have to add something, and in particular, the Terex hammer has a big triangular gem at the end. That's this one. But to print this in separate parts, you have to do it in several steps. Let's see, can I get that? Now it's wait. And there we go. So basically, it's four parts, two halves of a diamond, and two containing parts. To keep them together and not fall off, because these junctions work pretty fine if they're entirely round, but if you make them half round, I noticed that they have quite a lot of slack between them. What I had to do is to make sure that these parts also connect to each other. So there are some nooks over here. These basically fit in here. They are counterparts of each other. And at the end, I also made a double ring at the top so that you have basically a full ring worth of connectivity to the rest of the hammer. I actually had to redesign this part a few times before because it actually fell off once and then it broke to pieces. So basically that was what I had intended to tell everyone. There's a link here. You can use that to download all the files. They are available as STLs and they are available as open SCAD files. So you can actually modify the dimensions of everything you want. You can also download the model for these rings over here. And of course, some special credits to the people that helped me out. Harmless is a wonderful woman from Ultimaker that helped me a lot with the 3D printer stuff. Danzig is the one that actually brought me to the idea of doing things, and Themba and Fish are two good friends from the hackerspace that also added a bit of work. So, yeah. There's probably quite a few things that you might have wanted to know that I didn't cover so far. We have a decent amount of time left, so please do ask.
So we have plenty of time for questions, so please line up at the microphone and ask.
I can't believe it was that obvious.
Hello. You made crystals for your hammer, but...
Yes.
Since it's sugar, it's probably not very a very hard material. So is there a way you can protect it against damaging if you want to use it for the long term? Or is it actually really strong, the crystal?
Actually what happens is if you take like a cube of sugar, it's carved outside, I think. If you take a regular cube of sugar, like you put in your tea, those are basically very tiny sugar crystals that have been glued together, probably with their own material. The crystals on here are up to 1 or 2 centimeters in size. Crystals themselves don't like to fall apart. They break where they join with other crystals. So it is pretty sturdy. One thing that did happen, it's also the reason why I put it this side up front, is that at some point one person did actually trip over the thing. It's a bit of a shame. So there's a hole over here. There's little thing you can do about that, because then what happens is that you have a boundary between the mounting material, if the boundary between a bunch of crystals, a bunch of other crystals, so it forms a breaking line and it will just come off as a chunk.
Any more questions? Well, if there are no more questions, you are invited to come up and have a look at what Pastor has built for us up close. Mm-hmm. And otherwise, let's give him a nice round of applause for his amazing talk.
Mm-hmm. Yep. I added photos of basically all the things in the slides, but they're pretty small, way too small to actually get good on camera, so they're up here. And if you're really interested, you might even be able to take a sample home if you want.